Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Champion's Way, Football, Florida, and the Lost Soul of College Sports, by Mike McIntire, narrated by Barry Abrams. Preface. The gambler on the phone was threatening to kill me and break my legs, though not necessarily in that order. This was the late 1990s, and I had little experience writing about sports. I did know about corruption, however, which was why I had been asked to do a story about a wannabe sports agent accused of showering cash and gifts on promising basketball players at public universities in Connecticut and Massachusetts, including future NBA stars Marcus Camby and Ray Allen. My talent, if you could call it that, was ferreting out white-collar crime. Sweetheart real estate deals for state lawmakers, a briefcase of cash for the mayor, campaign checks from phony donors, that sort of thing. I did enjoy following pro football and baseball, but a college game was mainly for passing the time in front of the television on a rainy Saturday. So with no connections in the world of college athletics, I fell back on what I normally did. I searched public records and eventually wound up in the clerk's office at federal court in Connecticut, examining a petition for Chapter 7 bankruptcy filed by the sports agent. Seems he had borrowed a lot of money to finance his efforts to ingratiate himself with players. Among the $100,000 in debts he listed were loans from a couple of guys who liked to place bets on college games, raising the possibility that gambling money had made its way into the pockets of student-athletes, a mortal sin under the rules of intercollegiate play. Now, one of those sports bettors was on the line, insisting that if I put his name in the paper, he would drive to the newsroom and shoot me in the head. "I swear to fucking God," he shouted, "I will blow your fucking brains out." What to do? I decided that transparency was the best defense. When the story was published, I included his threats, figuring that if I later turned up dead, I would at least have been able to leave a big fat trail marker pointing to my likely killer. As it happened, I needn't have worried. I never heard from that guy again. My real enemy was one I hadn't even seen coming, the legion of rabid fans of University of Connecticut basketball who called to curse me out, make crude threats, and hurl insults. They weren't concerned that young athletes had taken money, jewelry, and plane tickets from an unscrupulous hustler with connections to gamblers. Rather, they were upset that I had drawn attention to it and besmirched the reputation of their beloved team. They took it personally. I didn't know it at the time, but I had just lost my virginity as a sports journalist. I quickly determined that it wasn't something I wanted to repeat anytime soon, so for years afterwards, I stuck to the relative safety of outing crooked politicians, most of whom did not enjoy a fan base sufficiently motivated to harass reporters. Still, the experience had left an impression, and it was not a good one. Professional sports, to me, had always seemed like the place to expect occasional unsavory headlines. The NFL or NBA player caught with a gun, or punching his girlfriend, or doing drugs in his Bentley. It was just a given that in a gold-plated fantasy land of bling, balling, and billion-dollar teams, adults would do stupid things once in a while. But college is supposed to be different. College is where students who are good at a sport, or at least enjoy it, can play in their spare time to round out their education. Sure, the really good athletes can also use it as a springboard to the pros, but at its core, intercollegiate athletics is intended as a healthy adjunct to the pursuit of an academic degree. Where did I get this crazy idea? From the National Collegiate Athletic Association, the governing body of college sports, which for a century has been saying that graduating from college is as important an achievement as winning on the field. But that clearly isn't true, and it never has been. When fans sit down in front of their 60-inch high-definition Samsungs for a college game on ESPN or one of the proliferating number of cable networks run by the colleges themselves, They're not hoping to find out how the players are doing in their math classes. They want to be entertained. AT&T, Capital One, and Coca-Cola, all NCAA corporate champions, pony up millions to associate their brands with that entertainment. And it isn't the graduation rates of the athletes that interests their marketing departments. Nor is that what university presidents and athletic directors dwell on when reclining in the skyboxes of their new luxury stadiums, hobnobbing with well-heeled boosters who help pay their salaries. In fact, the modern college athletic department is attached to the school in name only. It functions essentially as a subsidiary of corporate funders, unaccountable private booster groups, and professional marketing giants like IMG and Learfield, which are so embedded at some universities that they use campus offices and control everything from stadium advertising to the coach's radio show. The money to be made is so alluring that Wall Street has jumped in, with private equity firms bankrolling companies that cater to college sports. Along the way, this corporate athletics complex and its supporters in Congress have bullied the Internal Revenue Service and rewritten the tax code to preserve the fiction that it is all a tax-exempt educational pursuit instead of a nakedly commercial enterprise. The mind-boggling financial stakes. The NCAA's Division I alone had revenue of $8 billion in 2013, naturally leads to ethical compromises and the cutting of corners. Much of it occurs outside of public view, in the incremental decisions of administrators to trim academic budgets while borrowing millions for new stadiums, raise athletic fees for all students, and shift or cancel classes to accommodate games. At its worst, the negative effects are manifest in academic cheating scandals, lowered admission standards for star recruits, and the arrests of players for everything from rape to attempted murder, all poison to the carefully tended reputation of a school. How did we get to this place at our institutions of higher learning, where education, the law, and even basic morality take a back seat to the rapacious, smash-mouthed needs of the multi-billion-dollar business empire known, quaintly, as intercollegiate athletics? It only makes sense if you accept that big-time college sports exists as an end unto itself. Certainly it has its benefits. It gives local fans something to cheer. Students and alumni feel good about their teams, and for a select few schools, there are monetary and institutional rewards. But for the most part, it is simply an entertainment platform, broadcast to millions of viewers who have no attachment to the schools involved and directed by well-paid professionals whose primary mission is to grind out wins. From its earliest days in the 19th century, college football in particular has reshaped the perception and reality of American higher education perhaps like nothing else. It came thundering out of the storied campuses of Ivy League schools and steadily conquered public universities, initially bringing with it a trail of dead and injured players, complaints about vice and corruption of the game, and growing conflicts with the academic mission of colleges. Only intervention by President Theodore Roosevelt stemmed some of the physical toll on athletes with the creation of new standards for safer play. However, broader problems in that evolving world of college athletics remained unaddressed. Today, the roots of those problems stretch far and deep, drawing sustenance from warped cultural and business imperatives that were condemned as far back as 1929 in a Carnegie Foundation study as the darkest blot upon American college sport. That early inquiry found rampant corruption in recruiting, creeping commercialism, and misplaced priorities on the part of college presidents under the spell of big-time athletics. 60 years later, the Knight Commission on Intercollegiate Athletics found things had only gotten worse, nourished by a river of television revenue that served to amplify the basest instincts of everyone involved. The head of the commission concluded in 1991 that sanity had to be restored to this bleak scene and values put back into their proper place. Collegiate sports officials know this, but are too compromised to enact real change. This is made clear in internal NCAA documents, as well as in depositions from a major lawsuit against them by former players, who argued that they were basically functioning as unpaid entertainers while everyone around them profited. In their own words, when they thought no one else was listening, NCAA officials sent emails to each other admitting things like this. As we callous our collective consciences to the incremental intrusion of commercialism, "No, you can't do that," begins to be heard less often. I didn't set out to write about Florida or football. What interested me was the ever-rising cost of higher education. With one kid in college and two more on the way, I wanted to know why it was so damned expensive. Little did I realize that the path of that inquiry would inevitably disappear down the gaping financial gullet of college sports. I called Richard Miller, the former president of my alma mater, Hartwick College, a small liberal arts school in the upstate New York burg of Oneonta. Miller died in October 2014. I asked him to explain why the cost of attendance, less than $10,000 a year when I was there in the 80s, had now surpassed $50,000. Dick had since become the mayor of Oneonta and was freer to talk candidly about the subject. To my surprise, one of the first things he cited was athletics. As an example, Miller told me how Hartwick felt compelled to spend millions to upgrade its sports facilities after one of its competitors, Ithaca College, announced plans for a $65 million athletic center. Ithaca then upped the ante, saying it would add new hardwood basketball and volleyball courts to the mix. Hartwick drew the line at that, but Miller could not convince the trustees to save money by downgrading the school's only Division I sports, men's soccer and women's water polo, to the less costly Division III. In particular, boosters, alumni, and local businesses rose up to oppose the reduction in status for men's soccer, whose history of winning had earned struggling Oneonta the self-proclaimed title of Soccer Town USA. "It got very emotional," Miller recalled. "The numbers didn't add up, but for a lot of people, it was about more than that. And then you had the facilities foot race, trying to keep up with your competitor schools. It's really incredible, and it doesn't stop." If it's that bad at a tiny college in the Catskills, where sports isn't even a big priority, I thought, what must it be like at huge universities with high-profile athletics programs? The Virginia legislature, as it turned out, tried to answer this question in a series of lengthy reports on spending at the University of Virginia, released in 2013 with great fanfare, and then left on a shelf. Interestingly, the reports found that most spending at public universities isn't even on teaching, but rather in the benignly labeled realm of auxiliary enterprises, which includes athletics, student housing, and dining. Indeed, these categories have been the largest driver of spending increases at Virginia institutions, the report concluded. As for athletics specifically, none of the sports programs at Virginia's 15 public higher education institutions generated enough revenue to cover all of their expenses, meaning that most institutions, therefore, depend heavily on mandatory student athletic fees to subsidize their athletic programs. On average, 12% of what Virginia students paid in tuition and fees in 2012-2013 was directed toward intercollegiate athletics. Students coughed up $160 million a year in athletic fees on top of tuition, a 50% increase in 5 years. Then there's the awkward fact that the two highest-paid public employees in the state were the football coaches of the University of Virginia and Virginia Tech, each pulling down more than $2.5 million a year. But there's a caveat. Most of that money comes not from the schools themselves, but from private booster groups, university foundations, and endorsement contracts. I found this curious. How many other situations can you think of where a public employee presumably answerable to taxpayers, is paid by private individuals and organizations. To whom are they accountable if someone other than the public is buttering their bread? It was around this time that I happened to overhear my colleague in the investigative unit at the New York Times, Walt Bogdanich, talking about something called the Seminole Boosters. Walt, a three-time Pulitzer Prize winner, is one of those old-school reporters who still prefer to call someone or confront them on their doorstep rather than hide behind an email. He also talks loudly on the phone, and with my desk literally next to his in the newsroom, it's hard not to absorb the gist of his conversations. For months, he had been reporting on Jameis Winston, the star quarterback for Florida State University, who had been accused of rape but never charged. Walt had produced a blockbuster story detailing how university officials and local police had bungled the Winston investigation. Among other things, he reported that the lead detective on the case had worked side jobs for the Seminole Boosters, a private organization that supports Florida State athletics. The Seminole Boosters also helped pay the salaries of the coaches, the athletic director, even the university president. Walt and I started brainstorming about this peculiar organization. I was shocked to discover that it had more than $200 million in assets, was tax-exempt, and functioned largely outside the control of the university, yet was deeply entwined in the management of its athletic department. What was this group all about? Where did its money and influence come from? Florida State declined to answer many questions about its operations. The school was the happy beneficiary of the Seminole Boosters' largesse and didn't care to know much more than that. Bait set, I couldn't resist trying to find out more. This is the way investigative reporting works. You start off pursuing one thing and oftentimes end up far from where you began. And yet, not so far. The money that fuels college sports, after all, was a big part of the phenomenon of rising higher education costs that I had set out to explore. But that raised another, even more complicated question. Why? What was it about football and, to a lesser extent, basketball that drove otherwise rational university presidents, politicians, and alumni to suspend the laws of finance and critical thinking, throw away millions of dollars, and gamble the reputations of our citadels of higher learning on the precarious self-control of amped-up, reckless young athletes? Take Dr. Eric Barron. He is an educated man, a scientist, who spent most of his adult life studying oceans and geology, serving on NASA panels, and leading the National Center for Atmospheric Research until taking the helm at Florida State in 2010. Before he assumed the presidency of one of the largest public universities in the country, no one would have mistaken the diminutive, intellectual Dr. Barron for a fire-breathing football fan. Yet there he was on the night of January 6, 2014, on the field after a rousing nail-biter by the undefeated Seminoles in the BCS National Championship game, the collegiate equivalent of the Super Bowl, looking somewhat silly with red and yellow war paint on his face and a national champion's ball cap jammed on his head. Asked by a TV newsman what he thought of his school's thrilling come-from-behind win, Barron did his best to find some loftier lesson. "We have this expectation that every play will be perfect and that we'll march down the field and we'll be successful and we'll completely dominate on the score," he said. "But there's something really sweet about being behind and realizing that you're strong enough and you believe and you can march back and take it back." All in good fun. Except, not really. College football is deadly serious business. Nowhere more so than at Florida State. Dr. Barron may have genuinely learned to love Seminoles football, but it wasn't as if he had a choice. Much of his $400,000 salary was paid by the Boosters, whose single-minded goal is increasing sports victories at Florida State. The Boosters wield extraordinary influence. Even Dr. Barron's performance goals set by the university's trustees, some of whom are members of the boosters, included finding ways to enhance and support the partnership between the private boosters and the public university. The boosters helped build the Seminoles' Doak Campbell Stadium, the largest continuous brick structure in the United States, capable of seating more than 82,000. It is the pride of Tallahassee, Florida's capital. A single home game played there can inject as much as $10 million into the local economy. That means more money for everybody, from the cops working security jobs on game days to the local clubs and restaurants. And a winning season means big bucks for the coach, whose contract is filled with bonuses tied to victories, and the university itself, through television revenue and licensing fees. Vested interests abound. So when Dr. Barron's national champions took to the field that January evening, they didn't get there by themselves. It was a team effort in a much larger sense of the word. The Seminoles had help from police and prosecutors, professors and administrators, business leaders and alumni, defense lawyers and lobbyists. A whole off-field support network, sweeping up messes, propping up grades, paying for perks, and generally making it possible for Florida State University to stay focused on the pot of gold at the end of the college football rainbow. How else do allegations of rape, attempted murder, academic fraud, domestic abuse, and other scandals, some of them disclosed here for the first time, go unnoticed, uninvestigated, and unpunished? This is the untold story of what it takes to make a championship team. Champions Way. The Florida State University preserves, expands, and disseminates knowledge in the sciences, technology, arts, humanities, and professions, while embracing a philosophy of learning strongly rooted in the traditions of the liberal arts. The university is dedicated to excellence in teaching, research, creative endeavors, and service. The university strives to instill the strength, skill, and character essential for lifelong learning, personal responsibility, and sustained achievement within a community that fosters free inquiry and embraces diversity. Mission Statement, Florida State University. The Dedman School of Hospitality in the College of Business was located in a rather odd place on Florida State University's campus, the south end zone of the Seminoles football stadium, on Champions Way. To say that the mammoth stadium is the centerpiece of the campus would be an understatement. It is a monumental structure, designed to evoke what one architecture critic called Colosseum, religious, and fortress elements, that has academic and administrative buildings attached to the sides of it, like barnacles clinging to a tanker. The Dean of Students is there. So is the Victim Advocate's Office, where women who have been sexually assaulted seek counseling. Prospective freshmen are sent to Champions Way to begin their campus tour. Doak Campbell Stadium is the hot, throbbing heart of Florida State University, and one could argue Tallahassee itself. To get to Tally, gateway to Florida's provincial panhandle, you need to take Interstate 10 for hours, skirting the deep south underbellies of Georgia to the east or Alabama to the west. At the city limits, drivers are greeted by a sign heralding the national champion Florida State Seminoles football team. If Seminole worship were manifested as chromosomal X's and O's from a football playbook, it would appear in the braided DNA strands of Tally culture. Whole storefronts are painted garnet and gold. Billboards celebrate the team. People drive around with the national champion license plates. Loyal fans find it inspiring, and the university leadership fully embraces football as key to their school's identity. Others view the whole obsession warily. When the capacity crowd of more than 82,000 unites in a thundering war chant and swings its arms in a tomahawk chop, as fireworks explode overhead and a Seminole chieftain gallops out onto Bobby Bowden Field to plant a flaming spear into the 50-yard line, an outsider could be forgiven for thinking they were lost in a fascist fever dream. Christina Lynn Suggs unwittingly entered this world when she accepted a job as a teaching assistant at the Dedman School of Hospitality in 2013. As a 47-year-old mother pursuing a PhD in education, she was not the typical student. Petite, with an easy smile and a friendly way about her, Christie had always tended toward academic pursuits. She had climbed her way up from small-town Alabama, earning a bachelor's degree in psychology from Auburn in the 1980s, later going back to school to obtain two master's degrees. A hard worker, she was never without a job, and often had more than one. Tenured professor at a community college, research technician at a U.S. Army lab, substance abuse counselor, president of the board of a nonprofit suicide prevention service. Former colleagues and students were effusive in their praise of Christie, and comments like excellent work ethic, moral and honest, and compassionate came easily. Christie's personal life was not always as bright. Married twice and with frequent money problems, she often suffered from poor health and faced difficulties trying to have children. Once, she filed for bankruptcy, listing tens of thousands of dollars in credit card debts, medical bills, and student loans. When she and her second husband split up, she took with her their young son, Hunter. He was the light of Christie's life, and all of her decisions would be shaped around him. When she decided to return to school again, this time to get her doctorate, she chose a course of study, online distance learning, that enabled her to stay home with her son much of the time. She enrolled in 2008 at Florida State, less than 2 hours from her home in Dothan, Alabama. Florida State had thrown a lot of resources into the burgeoning field of distance learning, where students do most of their work over the web, often without ever setting foot inside a classroom. Some online courses had as many as 1,000 students. For her doctoral studies, Christie learned how to develop online classes and ensure their integrity. A frequent rap on distance learning is that it's too easy for students to cheat and difficult for instructors to monitor. She co-authored sophisticated academic papers on educational instructional systems, gave presentations, and received good grades. As she pursued her degree, she juggled multiple online teaching jobs for Florida State and other schools, cobbling together an income of less than $40,000 while also accumulating an even larger pile of student loans. In 2012, she lost her house and moved to an apartment in Tallahassee, where she continued homeschooling 10-year-old Hunter and struggled to complete her doctorate. Like many older PhD candidates who have to balance family, work, and school obligations, Christie found herself in over her head at times. She confided to friends that coming up with a dissertation project was harder than she had imagined, yet she expressed determination to see it through. By the time she arrived at the Dedman Hospitality School, she had a tentative schedule laid out with her advisor to develop a dissertation and complete her degree. She soon found that she was well-liked at Dedman and praised for her work. Things were looking up. Besides literally being situated at the football stadium, the hospitality school had a symbiotic relationship with athletics in other ways, given that its areas of study included the sports, entertainment, and food industries. Among its degree offerings was a major in PGA golf management. Some of its professors had backgrounds in sports management and tourism, which in Florida is closely tied to football, baseball, and golf. One of those professors was Dr. Mark Bond, a member of the Florida Tourism Hall of Fame, who ran the school's distance learning program. Dr. Bond appreciated the importance of Florida State athletics, having done studies on the economic benefits of Seminoles football games, which pump millions of dollars into the Tallahassee community. He served for 12 years as a trustee of the Tallahassee Quarterback Club, which gives an annual award, named after football legend and Florida State alum Fred Biletnikoff, to an outstanding college football receiver. He helped host an annual joint fundraiser for Deadman and the Seminole Boosters, attended by famous football personalities, such as retired coach Bobby Bowden. And he was friendly with football players, many of whom enrolled in his online courses. Athletes liked those types of courses because they tended to be easy and flexible, allowing them to do the work on their own time to fit their football schedules. Certainly, the hospitality school offered many traditional business classes that teach students how to manage hotels, restaurants, and resorts. But it was the online courses in such subjects as the history of wine that attract a large number of student-athletes, according to a meeting agenda for online teaching assistants from 2013, which said the university expected them to keep a close eye out for players with poor grades. Like on-ground classes, we're asked to review athletes' progress on a regular basis and report how they're doing to their academic advisors, the agenda memo said. Teaching assistants, usually graduate students earning money while in school, are the unheralded grunts of higher education, essentially doing a professor's work but getting paid peanuts. The online courses at Deadman each had an instructor of record, usually a tenured professor, but it was the assistants, or TAs as they are called, who stayed in contact with students, graded assignments and quizzes, prepared course materials, and more. There was also a full-time support staff that managed the teaching assistants' schedules and provided technical assistance and guidance. It was often hard to discern what the professors actually did. As a teaching assistant in the summer of 2013 for one of Dr. Bond's online courses, entitled Coffee, Tea, and International Culture, Christie followed protocol and compiled a list of students at risk of failing. Four of them were football players. One of them, defensive end Chris Casher, also struggled in another of Dr. Bond's online courses, International Wine and Culture. He had missed more than a half dozen quizzes and assignments for that class, blaming it on his need to help his mother while she recovered from surgery. Casher was informed of his precarious status. In response, he sent in a class project he had needed to complete, a simple PowerPoint presentation comparing wine from Chile and Belize. Virtually the entire project was lifted verbatim from online sources like Wikipedia and other websites. Unsure how to handle this flagrant flouting of academic standards, Christie alerted someone on the support staff in the distance learning program, Aiden Sizemore, who sent an email to Dr. Bond saying Casher had copied every portion of his project, with no citations or references listed. Students who hand in plagiarized work can get into serious trouble. The Florida State website says students must clearly identify the sources of information they use, and if text is borrowed verbatim, enclose it in quotation marks. Neglect of these indications shall be considered academic fraud. For athletes, there is an added concern. If they are not in good academic standing, they cannot play. That would be devastating for the football team, which in 2013 was gearing up for a much-anticipated fall season with a retooled lineup of promising players. It had been more than a decade since the Seminoles had won a national championship, and the university had invested millions to bring its football team back into contention, building a new stadium, hiring a new coach, and showering perks on athletes with the addition of student housing and academic tutors. Academics, in fact, was a big concern. Just a few years earlier, Florida State had suffered an embarrassing scandal involving cheating in online classes that led to forfeited wins for the football team, and many players arrived at school unprepared and overwhelmed with a busy training schedule. Already in 2013, the Seminoles had lost one player on Christie's list of at-risk students, senior receiver Willie Halstead, because he was deemed academically ineligible. Dr. Bond gave Casher a second chance. He told him to use paraphrases and references and explained how to do it. Paraphrase means to summarize what an author is saying using your own words. If you copy word for word, it must show what is being used word for word with quotations before the first word and after the last word. Casher was again late getting his revised work back to Dr. Bond, who, nevertheless, accepted it. Casher then asked if he could make up the rest of his missed quizzes and assignments, which would require the school to reopen his online access to them long after it had been closed. The policy was to allow such access only if a student had a documented excuse approved by the university within 2 weeks of the absence. In fact, the course syllabus made this clear. It is unacceptable to wait until the last week of class to try and request an extension for coursework due at the beginning of the semester. Dr. Bond told Christie that Casher has legit excuses and to grant him access. Christie soon found that football players, most of them beneficiaries of athletic scholarships, were frequently being allowed to miss deadlines, turn in subpar or plagiarized work, and make up incompletes in ways that other students were not. After linebacker Terrence Smith missed 2 weeks of assignments for coffee and tea, Dr. Bond had Christie reopen his online access to them, saying Smith would give him a medical note later. Three players, Nick Wasem and future NFL picks Timmy Jernigan and Trey Jackson, finished the spring semester with incompletes, and Dr. Bond allowed them to make up for them with a joint project over the summer. He told Jernigan in a friendly email to keep in top shape and accepted the project, sort of an imaginary travelogue of Japan and Italy filled with cut-and-pasted text from Wikipedia. Receivers Jared Haggins and Kelvin Benjamin, who later went to the NFL, were each allowed by Dr. Bond to hand in sections of incomplete projects past the deadline. Benjamin's project contained page after page of text copied wholesale from various websites that he listed at the end. Haggins at least attempted his own writing. Brazilian coffee is one of few places that has a carnival, and the coffee plays a major role just as much as the dancing and the food. Colombians drink instant coffee, and they didn't really drink their coffee throughout the day. None of it was college-level work. Dr. Bond instructed Christie to take off 15 points and accept. Dr. Bond's willingness to dock points from the two players for lateness was greeted as a rare victory by school staff. If he's enforcing some kind of penalty, then awesome, Aiden Sizemore said to Christie. But for Christie, a doctoral student in education, coddling truant football players made her increasingly uncomfortable. For one thing, some of them were rude and aggressive with her, complaining when she wouldn't allow them to complete assignments past the deadline. She had to admonish one athlete to check your tone when addressing her. More than that, though, their ability to avoid the normal consequences of irresponsible behavior was unfair. After all, her life was at least as difficult as theirs, albeit in different ways. Yet she played by the rules, while they seemed to walk between the raindrops, helped along by a system that placed the primacy of football above the integrity of academics. Tensions within the distance learning program reached the boiling point with James Wilder Jr., a talented running back who was headed to the NFL and had a history of run-ins with police. He had been arrested 3 times in the previous year, including for allegedly interfering with a deputy who was trying to take Wilder's former girlfriend into custody. He had to sit out much of spring practice with an injury, but Coach Jimbo Fisher was counting on his return as the fall season approached. Fisher told reporters Wilder had matured. "When you deal with adversity and realize that things can be taken away from you, it makes you grow," he said. "As a person, that's part of growing up." In the classroom, however, Wilder continued to have problems. He desperately needed a good grade in the coffee and tea course, but had missed some assignments. Rather than contact Christie, his teaching assistant, he reached out to Dr. Bond directly, saying he wasn't being credited for work that I know was submitted, and asking that other closed quizzes and assignments be reopened so he could complete them. Sorry I had to email you and should have went to the TA, but have worked with you in the past and feel comfortable discussing my academic career with you, Wilder wrote to Dr. Bond. With me having my daughter in town, I was very busy throughout the semester and wanted to make sure I have everything balanced. Please understand where I'm coming from, as this last year has been tough for me. At the bottom of Wilder's email were the answers to two discussion questions that he was submitting late. One was about the sustainability of the Chinese tea industry. I think that tea in China isn't sustainable at all. It's been getting worse and worse and worse every year. They're one of the largest producers of tea, and that means more money to be giving out. It's a lot that they need to have done. It's also a lot of land that have to stay on top of. Dr. Bond forwarded Wilder's email to Christie, saying, please use his submissions, and asked her to call him on his cell to talk about Wilder's grade. Christie had explained in a series of emails that there was no hope for Wilder to get the grade he wanted. She detailed the grades on all of his assignments before concluding, at this point, even if we accept this late work that he emailed you, and he gets 100% on the remaining work, he will still only get a D in the course. I have carefully reviewed James Wilder's grades and can assure you that the work he missed is because he did not do it or did not turn it in. I understand he wants a B in the course, but it is my opinion that he should have done the work like everyone else in order to get that grade. Of course, I will be happy to do whatever you want with regards to this situation. Christie then reached out to Aiden Sizemore, telling him about Dr. Bond's interest in Wilder. Sizemore was blunt in his response. Let me know what he asks of you, he told Christie. But other than the final project, don't set any adaptive releases unless I say okay first, trying to put a stop to his favoritism for athletes once and for all. Dr. Bond exchanged several more emails with Christie asking about Wilder, including one in which he signaled Wilder's importance to the football team. Let him know what he needs to get a C for the remaining work. If he has excuses for missing his work, we may accept them. However, let him know he needs to show us excuses. And please copy me on your email to him. He is a starting star running back. However, we have to watch out for all of these situations and must adhere to our grading policy for non-athletes and for athletes. Among other things, Dr. Bond told Christie to allow Wilder to hand in missing sections of a project past the original deadline. As with the other football players' work, the PowerPoint project was mostly a compilation of cut-and-pasted passages from websites. According to its digital metadata, the file had been created by a tutor in the athletic department for a different class, International Food and Culture, raising the question of how much of the work was even Wilder's. Concerned that she would be bending the rules, Christie contacted Sizemore again. I am not offering this opportunity to other students, she said, but I will do whatever you guys tell me to do. Thoughts? Sizemore said he would take it up directly with the head of the Dedman School, Dr. Jane Olin. This is above both of our pay grades, LOL, he said. I'll let you know as soon as she responds. As the hours passed, Christie grew worried. She emailed Sizemore that evening.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.